Programming the happy path and ignoring the errors that happen along the route has always been the most noble goal of validation. Yet this method doesn't look anything near that goal. It utilizes the result type containing either the positive outcome or the error. But that is not what I want. I want it done this way instead. This is programming to happy path. You can see one step, two steps, three, four, five steps, each producing an intermediate result and each actively ignoring any errors that might happen during their execution. Errors are eventually mapped into the status 400 bad request HTTP response. That is literally the only place in code where anyone pays attention to a possible failure. I still cannot write a method in this style, though. My result type does not support asynchronous mappings. That is what this video will be about, augmenting the functional result type with full support for async await. Please make sure to watch the previous two videos in which I have implemented the result type and the functional extensions for it. You will find the links to all preceding videos you should watch in the description. Here is the short story. These extension methods have turned the bare procedural result type into a monadic type. Map lets you apply a mapping to the value if the value is present. It would retain the error in case that it was a failure. If you are fond of functional programming, then this method plus the factory methods on the result class made it a functor. Then the next extension method, bind, made it a proper monad. It lets you apply a transform on the contained value, which produces a new result, either containing a modified value or a new error. Of course, any pre-existing error would remain. The remaining two methods are there for convenience. You can map the error if you like. You can also apply pattern matching to result by supplying two functions. Only one would be used to produce the ultimate value. These extension methods gave great power to results, making them a functional type that supports declarative coding. You would chain transforms that mold objects step by step into the final result. Nevertheless, the whole idea collapsed the first time I tried to apply it in a realistic web application that accesses a database. This is how it failed. The initial operation would return a result, either containing the domain object or a validation error response. After binding the subsequent operation, we would either have two domain objects or a validation error. Either of the operations could result in an error. Then, suddenly, I had to give up. The next operation is asynchronous. My idea was to add one more object or to have a validation error response once more, but I couldn't apply the asynchronous operation to a result. Therefore, my plan for this video is to augment the functional result type to support asynchronous mapping as well. There will be several asynchronous variants for each of these methods. I hope you like async and await, because there will be a lot of them from this point on. Please note that you can download the entire source code for this video before and after the change from my Patreon page. By becoming a patron, you are helping hundreds of other fellow programmers watch all my videos for free. You can find the link in the description. I will now start improving the functional result type by first augmenting the simplest of its methods, map. There are two possible reasons why this method might be asynchronous. First, the result to which we apply the mapping could be a task. Alternatively, the mapping function could produce a task. Either way, the entire map async method would be asynchronous, returning the task of result. Let's start with the task input first, and you will quickly see what I'm trying to do. It is really simple if you think about it. We must await the result first, and only then apply the mapping function using the common map extension method. I told you it would be easy. The other variant takes the common result object but applies a mapping that returns a task. This would be a little bit more engaged. We should check whether the result is a success before accessing its value and awaiting the mapping to complete. That is the success path. Otherwise, it must have been the failure, and it will remain the failure with the same error. The third and the most complicated possibility is the combination of these two. Both the result and the mapping are asynchronous. We must await the result first, but then we utilize the map async method above, only not forgetting to await its overall result. This completes augmenting the map extension method to support the async await pattern. It has always been the where to put the await game. And so we had two places to await, plus the third variant which awaits in both. Are you all right with this? Async await may be confusing at times, but if you concentrate on what is asynchronous and what is not, there remains only one solution to follow. Now, if you got this code straight in your head, extending the bind operation would be a walk in the park. There will be three variants again, each producing the asynchronous result object. One would apply to an asynchronous result. The other would apply an asynchronous mapping. And the third one would do both. All three methods will mirror the implementations you saw in the map async methods, like awaiting the result and then binding the mapping function, or awaiting the binding operation from the success result and producing the failure otherwise, or combining these two by awaiting the result first and then awaiting the bind async. There is literally nothing new in these three methods except that it is the bind operation rather than map. The map error async methods will scare no one. Another three variants that cover all the angles, I won't even read them for you. Augmenting the match method will be a tad more engaging. There are three possible sources of asynchrony in it. So let's begin with three variants where only one out of three items is asynchronous. It is still that same old question, where do I put the await? Another batch of three methods covers cases where two out of three items are asynchronous and a third one is not. The compiler thinks I have found the right places for all awaits. Let's not disturb them. There is a tradition in methods with many overloads to always add one more overload for the pot. This one will match an asynchronous result by either applying an asynchronous mapping to the success or a different asynchronous mapping to the failure. It is a total of 70 lines of code or so, and I have covered all the possible combinations of synchronous and asynchronous objects with synchronous or asynchronous func delegates. This code communicates some well-known lessons of functional programming. One is that functional libraries are usually small and powerful. The most difficult part of this library is to come up with an idea. The implementation is quite straightforward. Just find the right place to stick the await and it will all work. Still, this small asynchronous library will cause an earthquake in the place where I plan to use it. Let's start this mapping again, this time using full asynchronous support for the result type. I know what this will be in the end. It will be the iResult, which I must return from the minimal API endpoint. But I want to show you how we will get from the input arguments to that iResult in a series of asynchronous mappings. We shall visit the database several times, each time asynchronously. Some of the steps might produce validation errors. And still, all those objects will converge to that simple iResult object in the end. First, I will not need parentheses around this call. It would return an asynchronous result this time. I'm not worried about that because there is that bind async extension method. It would produce another asynchronous result. The await at the beginning will, in fact, await that result. This is the remnant of the procedural past. I will delete it and focus on the next stage in execution. I have moved this block into a helper method below, so I can call it here using another bind async call. That will give me yet another asynchronous result in line. It would contain a triplet with three objects that are all valid. Alternatively, it would be a validation error response object in case that any of the three operations above failed. Isn't this wonderful? Beyond this point, we can assume that the validation passed well. We can start creating the domain objects, eventually producing this large and complex entity. The next step is to save the entity into the database, followed by producing that I result. However, this last statement is not correct. I have deleted the construction of the bad request response, which I would need to return in case the ultimate result contained the error instead of the entity. Let's not hurry. I will first pull all this code into another helper method, which would be synchronous this time. Its sole duty is to construct the entity object out of valid ingredients. This method will fit easily because if you remember, the map async extension overload supports synchronous mapping functions. That will give us the asynchronous result, either containing the book or the validation error response, just as I wanted. One more step and we are there. These two instructions save the entity to the database asynchronously. It is another map async call that produces an asynchronous result of either a book or an error. That leaves us with the final mapping. This statement only covers the success part. I will also pull it into a helper method. How do I turn this asynchronous result into the iResult object? Well, that is easy. Use the match async extension method. In case of success, we shall take the book entity and turn it into the HTTP status 201 created response. Otherwise, there must be an error. Package it into the status 400 bad request response. Both hands of this match call will be the iResult objects. The overall result will be the task of iResult. Then this await at the very beginning will essentially await the iResult and return it. It only takes a moment to turn the entire endpoint into an asynchronous expression. It was a long journey from throwing exceptions over returning procedural result objects across using their monadic cousins, all the way through to combining synchronous and asynchronous variants in a realistic web application. Proper functional languages would remove even more of the boilerplate code I have here. But even in C#, which once was an object-oriented language, this code doesn't look bad.